in recessions, and again, I put my historian hat on, and maybe you'll say, well, it's different this time. I don't know why it will be. The Fed cuts rates 500 basis points in a recession historically. So maybe all this all along was more about getting more bullets in the chamber to fight the next recession, so that they don't have to go to QE again. They'll just end up cutting rates to zero. But I actually think in the next 12 to 18 months, we're going back to the zero bound on the funds rate.
Do the markets no longer think that a banking crisis is ongoing after last Friday's stock bounces in banks? Do economic data releases from last week indicate that a recession is no longer coming? And finally, who will win by the end of the year, market bulls or market bears? We're here to discuss these themes with our next guest, esteemed economist David Rosenberg, founder and president of Rosenberg Research. David, pleasure to host you today. Welcome to the David Lynn Report.
And it's an honor to be here, David. Thanks for inviting me on.
The honor's all mine, David. I've read your research. You do fantastic work. So we'll talk about your research towards the end of the interview. Everybody should check it out. Let's talk first about recent market action. Let me give you a statement, and please feel free to agree or disagree with this statement. First, we saw PacWest Bancorp shares rise by 80% on Friday. Crude oil has been rising today. On Monday, as we're speaking, it's up about 2%. Some would say that's an indicator of renewed optimism for economic growth and demand. And finally, the jobs report came in hotter than expected. Total non-farm payrolls rose by 253,000 in April, with unemployment relatively unchanged. And so the market bulls would argue that these indicators point to no more recession. How would you respond?
Well, I think that the recession is staring us in the face. And I know that people were talking about today that oil was up 2.5%, but it's down more than 40% from the highs. I mean, nothing moves in a straight line. You know, you've got some of these, you know, regionals, like you mentioned, PacWest. You know, that's bear market math, right? You go from $5 down to $1, and then you go from $1 to $2. And when you get to $2, you tell everybody, well, look, the stock doubled. Yeah, but you're still down, whatever, you know, like 80% from where you were. So that's classic bear market math. These regional bank stocks have been just crushed, notwithstanding the fact that, you know, what caused the recent rebound has nothing to do with anything fundamental, but with the fact that the shorts covered after making a boatload of money over the course of the past 6 weeks. The employment situation, employment is always the last man standing as you go into recession. It is a coincidental lagging indicator. The employment numbers have hung in. But, you know, the one thing that nobody talks about is what's happening with the work week. The work week has shrunk almost 1% in the past year. And that is a leading indicator. You know, employment is one of the conference board's ingredients in the index of coincident indicators, but in the leading economic index, what is in there? The work week. Because what happens as you head into recession is companies cut the hours before they start to cut the bodies. And in fact, there is this arcane statistic, but it's very important. It's really the entire kitchen sink as far as the labor market's concerned. And it's called the Index of Aggregate Hours Worked, which is looking at the labor market holistically, which is not just how many people are working, but how much time are they working. And you'd be surprised to know that that index peaked in January and has declined since. And so people say, yeah, you know, non-farm payrolls did this and the unemployment rate did that. But when you actually analyze the report, you're seeing that the leading indicators in the jobs data are actually turning down. Something else I focus on, for example, is temp agency employment, leading indicator. Temp agency employment is down 3 months in a row. And when the headhunters start chopping the heads of the people that work there, the general workforce isn't usually far behind. So you see, I spend most of my time looking at leading indicators to make sure my clients stay out of trouble. Coincident indicators, especially at turning points in the cycle, don't do anybody any good. I'll let the media types and I'll let my competitors talk about the veracity of these employment numbers. What I'm saying is that I am more focused on where is employment going to be in the next 3, 6, and 12 months, as opposed to what it was in April.
And of course, we have to remember that the employment numbers were recently revised down, right? Can you comment on that?
Yeah, well, yeah, and actually, it's a great point. We had significant downward revisions the previous 2 months that actually brought the level of employment below what the consensus was looking for, even with the better-than-expected April number. That's you had big downward revisions. They tend to be pro-cyclical, so they tend to feed on themselves. So that's something else to consider when you look at the household survey, the rival household survey. The job gains were more like 150,000, a good chunk of that taking place in part-time employment. Look, you can paint as much lipstick on the pig as you want, but the labor market is starting to show signs of cracking. I know that everybody focuses on non-farm payrolls. Jay Powell, that's almost all he looks at is non-farm payrolls. So I guess we have to look at non-farm payrolls. But when you're taking a look at other labor market indicators, jobless claims, well off their lows, the JOLTS data, which, you know, the job opening labor turnover survey, which has again has become a favorite of Jay Powell, well, you're seeing a precipitous decline in the last few months in new hiring and in job openings. And you're seeing a big decline in voluntary quits, which leads wages. That's a very good sign if you're in the disinflation camp, which I'm squarely in. And you're seeing a big pickup in layoff announcements. So these are all indicators of the future, not captured in on-farm payrolls. But I would say that you're starting to see some cracks behind the veneer of the headline data. I will continue to say more than half of the recessions that we've had in the post-World War II period, employment continued to go up into the early months of the recession. It's a lagging indicator, and unemployment tends to go down in the opening months of a recession. So for people that say, where's the recession? Where's the recession? Where's the recession? Well, you're not really looking in the right places. Employment, like I said, is last man standing. By the time employment goes down and the unemployment rate goes up, you're already knee-deep in the recession. And I think that'll be the next chapter of the story as we move into the summer months.
Another indicator you've talked about is the quit rates, which has been coming down. It's still higher than pre-pandemic levels, but it has been coming down from its highs from last year. What does the quit rates indicate to you as an economist?
Well, I call it the take this job and shove it index. So it's basically, it measures the degree of job hopping in the economy. People that are leaving their current job in search of greener pastures at another job. And as you had said, there was tremendous churning in the labor market during the pandemic. A lot of people, especially in the low-value-add, low-skill service sector, you know, whether it was restaurants or theme parks, anything related to travel and tourism, where there was a shortage of workers, you know, you just hopped around from one job to the next. And that led to the wage increases that we saw. Interestingly enough, the wage increases never caught up to inflation in this whole period, but we did have wage growth, obviously. But it's a fair point what you just said, and a very important one, because the quit rate is a bellwether leading indicator for wage growth. And when the quit rate, and you're right, it is at a high level, but it's rolling over, the direction is now going down. It's telling you that companies have finally paid their employees enough to keep them around. So it's showing that this job hopping craze is stalling out and reversing. And if you're an employer, that's really good news. If you're concerned that we're going to get a wage price spiral that's going to cause the central banks to tighten policy further, very beneficial news. Not many people know about the quit rate. Almost every economist does. But the fact that that has rolled over is very significant.
Well, let's talk about wage growth and inflation now, since we brought that up. So you're right, you know, wage growth is important. In fact, Jay Powell has commented on wage growth at his last press conference. Do you think wage growth is an important indicator for where inflation is going? Meaning, do you think that wages are tied to inflation?
Well, I think the most important thing that Jay Powell said at his press conference was that he wasn't convinced that wages cause inflation. And actually, we've done research on this at Rosenberg Research, where we actually found that the causation runs the other way, that inflation causes wages. Wages don't cause inflation. The labor market reacts with a lag to the price increases. Now, everybody always likes to look back to the wage price spiral in the 1970s, but in the 1970s, we had mostly a unionized economy in our hands, and most of the labor contracts had COLA clauses, which are cost of living adjustments. So we had built in institutionalized inflation back then. The economy is totally different than it was, you know, notwithstanding some wage settlements you're seeing right now. A lot of it is just playing catch up. The story in this whole cycle has been how wage growth has continuously lagged the increase in prices, so that wages in real terms have actually been contracting. So the wage increases have been bottled up in the prices. Now you're starting to see the prices moderate. Wages may lag a little bit, but then they'll start to moderate as well. So I think that Powell was quite right. He actually pushed back on that view that wages were inflationary. And I know why he would signal that, because there's a lot of evidence that suggests that the causation runs the other way, and that if inflation moderates, wages will moderate. Not that we're going to get wages pushing up inflation. It's going to work in the opposite direction.
What about the speed at which wage growth moves? Do wages move faster upwards or downwards typically?
Well, wages don't normally go down in the sort of society that we have. And so you're not going to be seeing wage cuts. You're talking about the rate of growth of wages will be positive, but will be slowing. Will wage growth be slowing by less than prices going forward? I expect that's going to happen. And so the beneficial part of this is that we may start to get to a situation where real wages tend to rise. So I think the wages will be sticky in terms of any moderation, although the moderation will come with a lag. The prices, I think, will moderate much more quickly than the wages will. And then the wages with a lag will follow suit, because wages, this is one thing I'm trying to stress, wages follow the price setting in the economy. The price setting doesn't follow wages. And that's exactly, I think, the message that Powell was trying to send.
Just on that note real quick, if you think that the rate of change of wages will be slower than the rate of change of prices, does that mean that companies' margins will be contracted by next quarter or perhaps beyond?
You're already starting to see the margin squeeze for a whole host of reasons. And the answer is yes. You saw it in the United States, for example, in the first quarter. We got the productivity numbers last week. Productivity was negative 2.7% at an annual rate. And so you're starting to see already how the labor costs are starting to pinch on what's happening on margins. And that's because they have started to, you know, leapfrog what's happening on the pricing side. And that's classic late cycle behavior in any event. But yeah, margins are coming under pressure for the exact reason you just cited.
Why is it that EPS revisions are going up? You commented on this in your report as well. Analysts seem to be more bullish on 2024 EPS outlook. Can you comment on that?
Well, what I wrote in my report was that it just caught my ear that on CNBC, the anchors were talking about how 2024 EPS growth is going up in terms of the estimates, to which I was thinking just slightly disingenuous, because in actuality, 2023 EPS estimates in dollar terms are coming down. Estimates for 2024 level terms are also coming down. So remember that before I talked about the beauty of bear market math, when you say, oh, well, look at, you know, PacWest stocks up 80%. Yeah. What's happening is that the estimates for 2024 are coming down, but at a lesser rate than the estimates for 2023 are. The estimates are actually coming down. The analysts are not turning more bullish. It's just that because 2024 is now being benchmarked off a lower base for 2023, the year-over-year growth numbers look better. But the actual dollar level estimates for next year every quarter are still coming down. That's why you got a forward multiple of 18. Got a forward multiple of 18. No, that's an earnings yield of, 5.5%? I would be more than happy to just clip a double B corporate bond at 6.75 and line up in a better part of the capital structure. That's a yield I can sink my teeth into. 5.5% for the equity market. But that's exactly what's happening. That's why the multiples are so high, because those earnings estimates for next year are coming down. 18 multiple, not a cheap market.
Over the weekend, Berkshire Hathaway held its annual shareholders meeting. Some notable quotes from both Buffett and Charlie Munger. Munger actually said that his advice to value investors is to get used to making less. What do you think of long-term growth in the equity markets?
Well, it depends how you define long-term. You know, the reality is that, you know, Warren Buffett is a renowned optimist. And we come out of the weekend knowing that they've been actually at the margin a net seller of stock and boosting their cash reserves. So if Warren Buffett's telling you that he can't find anything to buy right now, are you going to argue with that? So I think that, look, I still think we're in a bear market. I think we've been in a holding pattern for the past 6 months, but we're still in a bear market. And in terms of, I don't know how to define long term. If you drew the 100-year chart of the S&P 500 and you look at it, you'd want to buy it all the time. Depends on your time horizon. If you have a 5-year time horizon, 10-year, yeah, buy the S&P. It's filled with great companies. But there's going to be deviations and gyrations along the way. And so as I take it on a year-to-year basis, if you ask me about my view on the next 6 to 12 months, it's pretty bearish. I don't think we've hit the lows. Why would I think we're going to hit the lows? I'm going to argue with Warren Buffett. No. Am I going to argue with Bob Farrell, who was the dean of Merrill Technical Research for 6 decades, who said on my webcast not too long ago that he expects not just a retest of the October lows, but a break. But he's more bullish on 2024. And I think there's going to be reasons to be bullish on 2024. Once we get past the recession, once the Fed cuts rates and re-steepens the yield curve, once we get the equity risk premium to a more appropriate level of 400 basis points as opposed to 200 basis points, it's not an alluring, whether you're looking at absolute or relative terms, the equity market is not alluring at all as an asset class. So I would say, I could see turning bullish next year. But you ask me long-term, if you're a buy and hold investor, what beats the S&P over 10, 20, 30 year cycles? Not very many things. But if you're looking at the next year, you're looking at maybe getting in at a better re-entry point. I think that the market's going to offer that up to you. So I don't think you have to be impatient or be too quick to play these intermittent rallies, which have been repeated head fakes. Besides the fact, you're getting paid to be in cash at 5%. And risk for reward, if you want to dip your toes into the risk pool, the corporate bond market offers much better relative value, pound for pound.
Just to provide some context to the audience, when you said that the S&P could retest its October low, so the October lows were somewhere around 35 to 3,600 points for the S&P. Right. Right. And so you're talking about a 12 to 13% decline from current levels by the end of the year?
I think it'd be more. Well, you know, you just have to do what's the math? The math on a trough multiple in a recession and recession earnings would take you down to, call it 3,200 on the S&P. If you're talking about where would be the configuration of 10-year treasury yields and the S&P, to get to something you can sink your teeth into, which is a 400 basis point plus equity risk premium. You want to get paid to take on the risk. And so generally at the recession lows, you know, an equity risk premium of 400 to 425 basis points would mean you're down to like 3,400 on the S&P. The 10-year note is down towards, call it 2.5%. I think the returns in the next year are going to be better in bonds than in stocks. At some point, we're going to pivot towards the equity market, but it's not the right time of the cycle. If you don't have a recession view, then, buy the market. I have a recession view, and when people ask me why, I say two reasons. First, interest rates matter, and they operate with a lag. And I don't believe the business cycle has been repealed. So a lot of this rally that we've seen from the lows is predicated on the fact that the market seems to believe we're going to have a soft landing, not a recession. I don't think there is a get out of jail free card for a leveraged economy like we have coming off the most pernicious Fed tightening cycle since 1981. I'm an economic historian. We have not had a Fed tightening cycle of this magnitude without generating a recession ever. So I am not willing to say it's different this time. I'll let my competitors do that. I believe that patterns reemerge, and I believe there is nothing more powerful for the markets and the economy than interest rates. But they operate with a lag, and those lags are 12 to 24 months. And now we're into year two. And the lags are starting to kick in. We haven't seen it all yet. To talk about that, we've seen everything the Fed has done hit the economy and hit earnings and hit the financial strains. It'd be like saying in 2007, oh, the Fed went on hold in 06, 07. It's like, it's all good. It's all good. Or it's like saying in the spring or summer of 2000, oh, okay, so the NASDAQ's not doing so well. The Fed, you know, all the bad stuff happened in 01 and 02. You know, people just, they can't see past the tip of their nose. And today's investor base has really shortened their time horizons. But as Warren Buffett famously said, speaking of Warren Buffett, he said, most famous quote, in my opinion, the one that has touched me, because I am a historian at heart, is he said that the one thing that we learn from history is that people do not learn from history. So I think right now the stock market is a case of hope triumphing over experience.
So the stock markets, are they pricing in more rate hikes? Let's talk about interest rates or no rate hikes at all.
Well, no, the market right now, the swaps curve is priced in. I mean, you have maybe a little bit priced in for another June hike out of the Fed, but not much. And then you still have a couple of cuts priced in by the end of this year. I would posit that there's probably not enough rate cuts, not hikes. There's not enough rate cuts priced in. Now, again, this is a situation for me, or for any forecaster. Your forecasts hinge on your assumptions. My assumption is that we're going into recession. Why? Because I said the business cycle has not been repealed. And the Fed tightening policy ongoingly into a yield curve that it inverted last summer is as close to 100% ironclad recession call as there is. It's really a question, is it the second quarter, which we're in right now? Is it the third quarter? But it's somewhere in there, spring or summer, the recession starting. So you're asking about rates. Well, here's what I know about recessions. Recessions kill inflation. Even in the three recessions and the horrific stagflation during the 1970s, inflation went down. Now, when we got to the recovery phase, inflation didn't stay down, but recessions, every one of them, kills inflation. And in recessions, even in the ones engineered by the greatest inflation dragon slayer of all time, Paul Volcker was also the greatest interest rate dragon slayer of all time. He cut rates in the early 80s by 1,200 basis points once the inflation dragon was slain. Well, we've had inflation go down from 9% in June to 5% as we speak. Inflation for an economist is like this exciting race between watching paint dry and grass grow, but we are in disinflation. And I think in a recession with lower inflation, the Fed's going to be cutting interest rates significantly in recessions. And again, I put my historian hat on, and maybe you'll say, well, it's different this time. I don't know why it will be, The Fed cuts rates 500 basis points in a recession historically. So maybe all this all along was more about getting more bullets in the chamber to fight the next recession, so that they don't have to go to QE again. They'll just end up cutting rates to zero. But I actually think in the next 12 to 18 months, we're going back to the zero bound on the funds rate. And even if I'm wrong on that, think of the extent of the tightening. I mean, they've got the spot funds rate 5 to 5.25 throughout this whole COVID situation and the policy response and everything else we're talking about. The Fed has not changed its estimate of where the equilibrium neutral Fed funds rate is. They have left it at 2.5%, but the funds rate right now is 5 to 5.25. So what I'm saying here is that just to withdraw from the excessive policy restraint, just to get to neutral. In recessions, the Fed goes below neutral, but even to get to neutral would mean they'd have to cut rates 250 basis points. And that's not priced into the curve, but it's one of the reasons why I am very bullish on interest rates right now.
This is what Jerome Powell said at his last press conference on Wednesday. He said that participants don't see rate cuts this year. They just don't. He's alluding to the dot plots. And if you look at the dot plots, he's right in the sense that most participants and governors expect a rate hike, one more rate hike by the end of the year, not a cut. And basically, Jerome Powell was saying that the market is getting it wrong when pricing in a cut later this year. How would you respond to this?
Well, I respond two ways. The first is that this is the same Jay Powell and the same Fed that in the summer of 2021 had a dot plot for the funds rate at the end of 2023 at 0.625%. The dot plots were 5.8%. So you're telling me that I have to base my forecast on rates based on where these guys at the Fed think they're going to be. You know that they get their Fed funds forecast wrong 2/3 of the time in the past. The one thing they can control, and they get it wrong more than the typical Wall Street economist does. It's incredible. They were calling for 0.625%. We're going to end up over 5% for this year. So I'm actually going to do my own work, and I'm not going to rely on the FOMC. The FOMC right now is actually doing battle with its own Fed staff economists. At the last FOMC meeting, the one in March, the Fed staff in the minutes came out and said, we're going to have a mild recession in the second half of the year. And they said that inflation and core inflation are going down to 2%, not just in 2024, but in 2025. The Fed raised rates anyways. And then the Fed raised rates again at the last meeting. And when you read the tone from the FOMC participants, they don't buy into the Fed staff forecast. But guess what? I do. So I think that, again, if we get, it doesn't matter if it's a mild recession. We had a mild recession in 2001, and look what interest rates did back then. The funds rate went from 6.5% to 1% in the context of a mild recession. So I'm in the Fed staff camp, and so I think that rates are going to come down, and the Fed will be adjusting their... The Fed, which adjusted its dot plots in rather dramatic form, when you go back to the... And we're not talking going back 5 or 10 years. This is the summer of 2021. The Fed basically told you, we have no intention of raising rates off the floor for the foreseeable future. Oops. I mean, this is like a case, David. This is like a case of, Lucy and Charlie Brown in the football. So my sense is that the Fed pivoted hawkish to hawkish, and they'll pivot again dovish. So one thing we know about Powell is that he changes his mind. And my forecast is that he'll be changing his mind again.
Okay. And just on the note on pivoting, so your stance is 500 basis points, if I'm quoting you correctly, 500 basis points over the next 12 to 18 months. I'm just curious to how you arrived at that timing, given that the last two rate cycles, so I'm rate hike cycles, I'm quoting 2016 to 2019. So in 2019, when the rates went up to 2.25 to 2.5%, it stayed elevated for less than a year, for about 6 months to 8 months. Before it came down. Before then, in 2006, it stayed elevated for about a year before 2008 happened, and then it went down. So historically, they held rates for about up to a year. What about this time?
No, normally the lag between the last rate, I mean, you mentioned a couple of cycles, but when you look at all the Fed cycles historically, they typically wait 6 months. You know, and look, sometimes you don't get a recession, like 1995. In 94, in the early 95, the Fed doubles the funds rate from 3% to 6%, and we didn't get a recession. There might have been a recession in Mexico and Orange County, but there wasn't a recession, but the Fed still cut rates three times. In a soft landing, like you had in, for example, in 1998, when they cut rates around long-term capital and the Asian crisis, they cut. If you believe that, if you believe it's a soft landing, they'll cut rates three times. I'm thinking that even in a soft landing, if inflation comes down, they might have more room, because the one thing that you didn't mention was whether it's under Bernanke, you know, and Yellen, or whether in 2016, or whether you're talking about Powell in 2019. Those periods, the Fed did not take the spot funds rate so far above the neutral funds rate. Like, we're talking about the mother of all tightening cycles. This is not, you got to be thinking that they will be reversing, if not all, then most of this tightening cycle. So, you know, if the Fed had gone to 4% from zero or three, yeah, you and I could be having this conversation, but David, they're already at 5. Neutral's a 2.5. Just to get to neutral, they'd have to cut 250 basis points. In recessions, they cut rates more than 250. They normally go 500 basis points. Now, I'm just saying, what has been the normal reaction function in the past? And a lot of things have to go right. I mean, unfortunately, the economy has to go into recession, but recessions and expansions are tied at the hip. We can't deny that recessions are part of the business cycle. Thank God that recessions only have been around for 15% of the time. Expansions are around 85% of the time. Who doesn't think that's great? But to say that, well, there's no recession, is to ignore the historical record. Who wants to do that? You know, when people go to the betting tracks to bet on horses, do they ignore? Do the pros who go and bet on horses, do they ignore the history of the horse, the job? Do they just look at the weather? They look at all the history. We're talking about how history is so important here, because patterns reemerge and the cycle is the cycle. So what I'm saying is that I think they'll be cutting rates more than expected. And the reality is that when rates come down, you're right. They can come down in dribs and drabs, like you can argue in 98, or you can argue in 96. You can even argue in 2018, 2019. But those weren't recessions. And the funds rate wasn't that far above neutral. In fact, by the way, I think the Fed's estimate of neutral back in 2018, 2019 was 3%. And Powell never even got the 3% in that, you know, when he was under the magnifying glass of the Trump tweets, he never got to neutral. And then he cut rates. I mean, think about that. They never got to neutral. Then he's cutting rates at a time of full employment in 2019. He cuts rates three times. You're telling me this guy's not going to be cutting rates when we go into recession? But look at the level. Look at where we are benchmarked against the neutral rate. That's what I'm talking about. And there's so much opportunity here. Because it's going to be very bullish for bonds. And then we're going to get to a situation where bonds and stocks will get more realigned, where I will gladly shed my my bear fur and start to grow bull horns. So, and that I expect that's going to happen next year. But you see, the thing is that the bond market's going to have to play ball first. Before you turn bullish on stocks, you have to be bullish on bonds. And the Fed's going to play a role.
So that's your play right now. So that's your play right now. More pivot into bonds than equities. Until the bear goes back into hibernation next year.
Well, the cycle's the cycle. So yes, I anticipate, and you'll be the first to know about it, David, and your listeners, that next year Dave Rosenberg will morph from perma bear to perma bull.
I appreciate it. There's probably more to talk about before that morph happens. Final note before I let you go, you brought up some very interesting and important stats about consumer credit in your latest report. This is important. Why are consumer debts going up, into particular credit card balances? Are consumers expecting a renewed economic growth, which is why they're optimistic about spending, or are they spending out of necessity with their credit cards?
You see, it's a great question, and I don't think anybody really knows the answer. But you've got to be thinking, if the household sector has all this excess savings that all the economists talk about, and I think that those savings from the previous stimulus checks have already been spent, not by the wealthy class, but by middle and low income households, that money's been spent. We're apparently getting this wage boom. Isn't that everybody's talking about the wage numbers from last Friday's payroll report? Well, so if you have the excess savings and you have the big wages, why on earth would you be ramping up your credit card debt like it's nobody's business in the past several months at a 24% interest rate? Why would you be doing that? So I think that it's out of some desperation that you are finding, and actually you're seeing evidence of that. It was in the Fed's base book. Yeah, people using their credit card to buy food and to buy gas, to buy the necessities. It's not a good thing. No, this is actually, if we were at the beginning of an economic expansion, people were feeling confident, interest rates were low, you'd be taking our credit card debt. Why would you be doing it now? And that calls into question a lot of the other economic indicators, calls into question the actual level of liquidity and excess savings in the balance sheet of the consumer sector, calls into question as well the veracity of these wage numbers. Because if organic wages are going up like they say, why would you have to go tap your credit card to these exorbitant interest rates?
I offer one more theory. People agree with your outlook on interest rates, which is that they're coming down.
Well, the problem in the credit cards, considering that the delinquency rates and default rates are going up, is that those rates will not be coming down nearly as fast as the Fed funds rate or as fast as Treasury yields. They will be stuck at high levels to compensate lenders for the higher default risk.
So no real relationship there. Well, David, that was a fantastic talk. I appreciate your time. Where can people learn more about your research and follow your work?
Sure. Well, come to information at rosenbergresearch.com. Takes you to the website, log in, and we offer everybody a 1 month free trial for everything we do, written and oral. Best way, or you can just Google Rosenberg Research. It'll take you right there. The worst thing that can happen to you is you get 1 month of our daily, weekly, monthly products and webcasts for free. Hopefully you'll find it appealing enough that you want to become a client. But the 1 month free trial is for those who want to kick our tires.
Yeah, great research. So I'll put the link in the description down below. Everybody should check it out. I'm just curious, your morning reviews are called Breakfast with David. Do you ever do breakfasts with clients in person?
That's not usually a freebie, but I do. I do, and you'll see a lot of the stuff because I'm a foodie. But there's also Buffet with Dave. That's the weekly. But yeah, I know I do dinners, lunches, you know, you want to meet me over a glass of wine. We can do that too.
All right. Excellent.
Yeah.
I look forward to speaking with you next time. Plenty of news to discuss. Thank you very much for being on my show today and for spending the time with us.
Thank you, David. Appreciate it.
And thank you for watching the David Lynn Report. Stay tuned for more and don't forget to subscribe.